What are you doing over there? Struggling with some? You can't even open that over there?
Yeah, well, there was a sticker on it, and if I opened it, then the sticker would have went right into the mouth, and you can't drink sticker beer.
You can't be drinking no sticker beer.
No.
Nice. Tommy, I'm a big fan of those vulgar four-color words. Are you aware of these four-color vulgar words?
Like the F words, like flag, frog, like those ones?
Absolutely.
Yeah, I love them.
The other day, some dude came up to me and he's like, "What's your problem?" I said, "What's your problem, flag?"
Ooh.
Ooh.
You never call another man flag.
He stepped right up. I'm like, "That's right, banner. You back up."
Did you? Well, somebody stepped up to you and you didn't piss your pants?
I would never piss my pants in public. That's your domain, sir.
Yeah. Not because people stepped to me. It's because people gave me shots.
It was actually Step Up 3D, and we had a dance battle right there in the hood.
Mm.
It was great.
Right outside beautiful Flint, Michigan. Huh?
USA. I like to swear. It's true. I'm not sure if you know that about me. I'm a man that curses occasionally.
I think that's how we became friends.
Yeah, maybe. It's
I don't
possible.
Trust a person that doesn't swear.
No.
You know what I mean? Like if I'm hanging out with a group of guys and there's one guy that gets offended by swear words, I'm like, nah, I'm not going to talk to
you. I remember the first time I hung out with you, just me and you.
Oh, God. Our first date.
Yeah, our first date. Well, for whatever reason, it was me, you, and our friend Dave, and we were going to Taco Bell. And for whatever reason, Dave took a different vehicle.
Really? I don't remember this. Was this when Dave was living in the Aldridge estate?
Yeah. So me and you were in the same car. You were driving. And
this isn't true. The first time we hung out was at the movies.
Yeah, but I'm saying me and you, us two, on our date.
Well, Dave was there.
Yeah, but he wasn't in the car with us, so we could do some heavy necking and stuff, you know.
So who drove the car?
You did.
Oh, wow.
I said that already.
So I drove the car to Taco Bell.
Oh, boy, Speedy, you're really quick on the uptake.
But you said Dave took a different route.
Yeah, he took a different vehicle for some reason.
Oh, so we're following Dave.
Oh, my goodness, yes.
I see what's going on.
Connecting the dots, that's what you're hearing, folks.
I might have been drinking tonight.
Oh, maybe. So it's me and you. You're in your shitty, like, gray car or something.
Oh,
there's garbage everywhere.
Not my car.
You plug in a CD and you start waggling your stupid fucking finger like you do. And you're like, "This is my song." And it was Social Distortion, Winners and Losers.
Oh,
and you're like, "I listen to this fucking song every single day and I decide, am I going to be a winner today or am I going to be a loser?"
That sounds like something 21-year-old drunk me would say.
Yeah, and I'm like, Jesus.
Wow, I forgot all about that song. Do you have it queued up?
No, I wish I did.
Oh, we got to.
We'll do it later.
Winners and losers.
Yeah, I'm like, man, this weird little punk kid with his dumb spiky hair is really intense or something. I don't know what's going on.
Wow, I forgot all about that song. Maybe that's where my life went off track.
Well, you stopped listening to Social Distortion.
To that song specifically. Mike Ness, where are you right now?
Yeah.
I need you.
In Tommy's heart, not his soul.
Well, it's coming back. It's all Mike coming
Ness,
back. All
Mike Ness, you ain't doing shit. Go implant yourself in Tommy's soul. Help a brother out, please.
Quit doing two shows in San Diego, California a year.
Nobody cares about Whale's Vagina, California.
Wow, Winners and Losers.
Yeah.
I remember buying that CD, and the day I bought that CD
Nostalgia.
I went over to Abe Falcon's house, and there's a song in that CD. It might have been Winners and Losers. There's a song where it's me and you in a six-pack walking down the railroad tracks. And so I told Dave we got to walk down the railroad tracks to the liquor store and get a six-pack, and we did.
It's just like the song.
We're living Mike Ness.
You were walking down the tracks with your six-pack, and you set it down, and you both hopped in the air and high-fived, and the time froze. Freeze frame.
You don't high-five when you're a badass. But
well, yes, as you two were.
Half hug.
Yeah. I am a fan of swearing. However, I still find it very, very shocking when I'm out in the general public and you hear a loud F-bomb dropped.
Yeah, but you don't really hear that much anymore, do you?
Not anymore.
Unless you're at a bar.
It just depends on where you're at.
Where were you?
Well, the least... So, okay.
I guess it is shocking because I'm like, where were you that you would hear that?
Right. Exactly. If you heard it, your head would whip around because somebody dropping the word fuck in the general public is the human equivalent of a dog whistle. You turn your head and you got a fucking look. You're like, ooh.
Nobody does that in the grocery store.
It wasn't the grocery store.
It wasn't.
No. So I graduated from a town that's basically a cesspool, graduated high school.
Yeah.
And I do my very, very best to avoid it like no one's business these days.
Yeah. Just had a bad time, huh?
Well, I didn't have a bad time. It's just, like I said, a cesspool.
Yeah.
Do I like to wade in with the scum? I do not.
It's gotten pretty bad.
Yes. So the closest I get is on the outskirts of town to the combination McDonald's, laundromat, and gas station.
Yeah, I was going to stop there tonight, but you said you needed a shot, so I stopped deeper in the hood.
So this place is the crossroads of hell, really.
It's where I usually stop to get your beer, Randy.
Yeah. You walk into this establishment, and it's basically a world star hip-hop video just waiting to happen. I'm just setting the scene for the people so they understand what this place actually is.
Yeah, you could probably find a heroin needle or two in the parking lot.
Yeah, yeah. Probably heroin still in it, in fact.
Don't go around back to pee like I do at some gas stations.
No.
Don't do that.
No. One time I found one of those needles in the parking lot, and I stuck it right in my eyeball because I love my drugs.
And that's what happened to Randy.
Not all, but the majority of the people in this town think they're in a reality show called Extreme White Trash, where the goal of the game is to be the douchiest, dirtiest person you can possibly be.
Well, it's right outside of beautiful Flint, Michigan, right on the border.
It's right on the border, yeah.
Most people probably, I'd say 50% live in Flint.
Maybe.
It's right there.
It's all tank tops, Coors Light, and four-wheelers.
Want to see my quad? No, I don't. I'm not 13.
I wouldn't be surprised if they drove their quad to the laundromat.
I've seen it.
Yeah.
I've seen it. Yeah. Like, why are you so cocky and confident, all you people there? You're missing four of your front teeth, and you look like you're perpetually dirty.
Because their 15-year-old cousin told them they were cute.
Yeah. Just constant, just greasy dirt smudges all over their face.
I know.
That's my white trash camouflage. It's in case a predator comes finds me.
I met Jordan a couple times.
Yeah. I've always thought that the missing link is actually the caveman that discovered toilet paper. Yeah. He invented TP and learned how to wipe that ass after he goes number two.
You don't want to do that at this gas station, by the way.
So all the lady cavemen flocked to this man because he smelled less like butt than the rest of the caveman population. Sure. So those genes spread. Evolution, there it is. These people in this town that I graduated from, just one step above that caveman, because...
Can we say the name of the town? I mean, I feel like we're right there.
Mount Morris, Michigan, USA.
There you go.
Because you can tell maybe they wipe their ass every now and again, but they still have that earthy smell to them, so not that well. They don't really wipe it that well.
In the name of the town, like, I don't know if you were going to edit that, but you said it real quick. The name of the town is Mount Morris. Is there, it's MT.Morris. Is there a mount
in there's a lot of mountain going on, and other it's than, all other nasty than
Chelsea
sex.
That everybody yes. Is she the mount?
Other than Chelsea, the 58-year-old barmaid and the hole in the wall by the tracks.
Right on Dort Highway.
So anyways, I'm in Mount Morris, Michigan. I went to the library, me and my sister. They were having a little book sale or whatever, so we stopped in, right?
Yeah.
And we walk in. And there's all these old folks all dressed up.
There's good people still in Mont-Morris. It's not all bad.
This was blowing my mind, though. There was probably, I shit you not, like, and this library is kind of small, but there was probably 30 to 35 older people sitting at tables, and they were having a book club.
They weren't giving you pamphlets about Jesus?
No. They were, I don't know what they were. Reading or anything.
What they were preaching.
I don't know what they were reading, but man, they were getting in depth. Like, this wasn't like, I like the part where Sally bought a dog. You know,
this is like the adventures of Huck Finn.
No, this was like the adventures of Cliff Notes, because they were like, well, I read a story about the 18th century literature on outhouses in America, and
That might have been interesting.
They were. I was impressed.
Why didn't
right?
you sit down?
Well, I was admiring from afar. I didn't know what book they read. might have been Mein Kampf for all I know.
Whoa.
Right? You can't just sit down in a book club and participate. You don't know what you're getting yourself into.
Sure. But that's kind of the excitement.
Oh, we read Charlotte's Web. Well, I'm just going to weep for hours now.
If I was there, Randy, I would have asked him what was going on, and you goddamn well know it.
Hey, guys. My name's Tommy. I'm a good guy. What are y'all doing?
Sorry, I've been drinking today.
Yeah. I know this might shock you, but I'm drunk.
So it was super
cool. We know you.
It was a way classier experience than I expected, right? Because I'm expecting the worst when I go to this Mount Morris town. So me and my sister walk out to the parking lot. We parked in the very back. We start going to to our vehicle, and we start hearing this woman's voice.
Oh.
Yeah.
She's screaming, Randy.
No. And it sounded like she was having a conversation or something. So we round the corner, and here's this woman. And she looked like you expected your classic mom to look, like a short, boyish haircut.
Right.
You know, glasses, frumpy as all get out. Except she had a few startling alterations to her stupid body.
Hmm. What was that?
Well, she had shitty green blobby tattoos all over her body.
Sounds typical for Mount Morris.
Yes. And I say all over her body, that's a key point, because she was wearing a bathrobe that was thrown open. And the first thing I see when I round the corner are her blue and white striped panties.
Yeah.
Indeed, and her dropping her phone and saying, fuck, flip phone, mind you.
Was this me? Like two years ago, was this me?
And it landed right next to her walking boot, yes.
Oh my God, this was me.
So here's this naked woman, practically. She had bra and panties, robe flying in the wind like she's a superhero.
Not the Flash.
67 pounds overweight if she was an ounce. The grossest woman. And she had just dropped her flip phone next to her walking boot. She goes, fuck, where the fuck is he?
Uh-oh.
And, you know, she's looking around, and I'm like, oh, my God, look at this. So we carefully skitter by, and we start walking to my vehicle, and probably about four vehicles down from where this woman is swearing and flashing the world was a man in a truck, big truck. He had his windows down, and he was blaring Def Leppard. Fool Dan.
Well, there he is.
At maximum volume. So I'm like, he's right here. And he's rocking his ass off.
Right.
Okay.
Good for him. Fool Dan.
The moral of this story is you can't go home again, Tommy.
Which I think might also be an 80s Def Leppard song.
It is. Is sure. It really? There's also a 80s Def Leppard song called Beware the Fat Woman in the Striped Panties.
Don't go to the Mount Morris Library.
Yeah.
Volume 2,
The Reckoning. There's also a famous 80s song called Drop That Beat, D-Boy.
Put it in. I'm drinking summer shandy on Thursday. We so motherfucking out here though. We never been this out here.
Woo!
So strange when it's changing the speed.
What you know about Leonard Skinner? Whack of the intro, the hot of the verse every time, baby.
Well, I've been working like a working man do. Got my
my act together. Gonna walk all over you. Pressure pushing down on me, pushing down on you. Shit, let's raise the roof. Woo! About time, it's the era of the rebels. Cloud nine and the air up in the vessels. Generation fearless, got a taste for weirdness. Flow on fire, that's the way my beard is. Hard times, jump starting to grind. It's all good, y'all. Things fall apart sometimes. Let it go, let me know when you're ready, though. Don't push me, cuz until the edge I'm close. When the time comes, ride for something. Or live to be nine and then just die for nothing. Speak their heart, your baby, speak their mind. And I'ma play their part and I'ma freak that rhyme one time for you. Rhyme one time for you. I'm an island, man. There ain't nothing else by me, man. And I drink enough whiskey to float a battleship around this bitch any motherfucking how. Wow. I'm up in a mix and a place to be. You're down for the night, come on for me. Like ABC.
Welcome to the Miserable Retail Slave Show. We're coming to you from the Pod Shack outside beautiful Flint, Michigan, USA. My name is Randy.
Hey, I'm Tommy. I'm
hey, old too. Tommy Thompson there. How you doing, buddy?
I'm doing pretty good. I've had a couple of drinks tonight.
Oh, man. The devil's liqueur.
Yeah, you're
down
me.
Your throat. Satan himself French kissed you tonight.
I think I'm doing okay, though.
Are you?
Yeah.
I'll be the judge over here of that.
I think I haven't eaten today.
Jeez. Listen, you got enough fat reserves to get you through, okay?
Oh,
we're
man.
Okay.
More and more every day.
I'm glad you're not fighting it anymore.
Yeah, I kind of quit going to the gym.
Okay.
Just giving up.
That's what I expect from you. You're a quitter. Other than alcohol.
My body just wants to be at 250, and I just got to accept that.
You got to accept it.
Mm-hmm.
Just your body believes in manifest destiny. It needs to be everywhere all at once. Just let it expand.
Just get my double B cup bra and I'm good.
You're fine. You know, I see you walking in the room. I'm like, man, look at the tits there.
Well, I don't blame you. Yeah. I kind of throw them out there.
Yeah. So hey, everybody, how's it going? We're talking about Tommy's tits. Thank you for listening,
Mister Bitch Tits.
Yeah, we're all in the economy of attention. And our currency is your eyes and your ears. So thank you for giving us your fucking money.
Sure.
You know?
If you are, go to the Patreon page.
Yeah. Everything's a disaster, Tommy. Did you realize this?
Oh, my God. Yeah. Yeah. That's why I drink again.
Yeah. See? You know.
I mean, it's not getting better.
Tommy's fucked and doomed over there. There's no help for him. It's a lost cause. He's just a tar pit of happiness. Everything gets sucked down to the quicksand of his decrepit soul.
Sure.
Yeah.
Tar pit of happiness that cries every day.
Yeah. Am I making you feel better?
Sure.
I love to.
I'm getting the chicken.
Yes. Like I said, I've got that leather-bound notebook of all the times you mess up. And I just, oh, boy.
That's what's going to send me over the edge.
Is it?
That's it.
Should I recite from it?
Sure.
The first day I met Tommy, this is what happened. I wish I had a soundtrack to my life.
Well, why don't you create your own?
Wow, that was a weird voice.
Yeah, I don't know why I got really high. Why don't you create
your
own?
What are you, a cartoon character over there?
Very animated.
I'm just saying, like, years ago I saw this man, and he was, every time I saw him, he was walking around with a stupid Walkman. And his ears.
Not me, by the
no,
way. Just
no. And I was like, man, this guy is creating his own soundtrack to his life. Because in the movies, those scenes where the fucking music kicks in, especially in the 80s, those were the best scenes.
Sure.
So I'm like, this man must be living the best life possible. He's like, my life is awesome. Listen to this fucking music.
Kick the Guns N' Roses.
Exactly. You know, he's got Sweet Child of Mine blaring as he picks out paint chips. Oh. You know? So that's where I am. I need a soundtrack to my life.
You going to be the crazy Walkman guy?
I might be the crazy, no, iPhone guy.
Oh, right.
Get nowadays. With the times, brother.
Get in the real world.
Yeah. I mean, if you had a soundtrack to your life, what would it be? Just walking around.
God. Like, oh, you're not literally asking me?
I am literally asking you. I directed a question towards your general direction.
Well, as you may or may not know, I'm very into 60s and 70s rock.
Yeah,
and
so probably some funk because that seems
to be... Outlaw country.
Probably some funk because that seems to be what you're in right now.
Or punk rock.
A funk.
Yeah, I'm in a funk.
See?
Yeah.
Listen to some funk and hip hop. Yeah.
Get some James Brown. Get some Brown in Curtis your life. Mayfield.
Get some Mayfield up in there.
Hell yeah. Earth, Damn, Wind, and yeah. Fire. Get some funk soul. Yeah.
The Carpenters.
Oh. Don't you remember when you told me you love me, baby?
See, isn't that sexy as all get out? I'm creaming my jeans just at your interpretation.
I can't help it, Randy.
Maybe that's what you need.
Yeah?
Yeah, be earbud man.
Is this an intervention?
It is.
I drank one time on the podcast and Randy wants to get me an intervention.
Yeah, one time. Okay, buddy.
Well, one time in what, the past... 2 months, two times in the past year.
Two times in the past 2 weeks.
Yeah, but this is the second time in the past 3 weeks, and but second time in what, a year and a half?
We could do all the statistics of math you want to.
And I'm okay tonight. Don't act like I'm not. Okay. I'm good.
I'd probably pick some Van Halen, probably specifically Sammy Hagar.
Yeah, you look like that tool.
Yeah, exactly, because he's the way he sings... Every Van Halen song, no matter how ridiculous the lyrics, makes it sound so fucking important. Like it's like it's life-changing philosophy. It's amazing. Like at the Retail Paradise, like that gamefully employs me. They play a song called I don't even remember what it's called, but here's the lyrics. And I swear to God, every time I hear it, I'm like, preach it, brother. And they don't make sense, especially when they're written down. And then you sense a change. Nothing feels the same. All your dreams are strange. Love comes walking in like some kind of alien. Waits for the opening, then simply pulls a string.
Wow.
Isn't that deep?
Mr. Sammy Hagar. Mr. Quabble Wobble.
I mean, listen to it. I have to bring the song up now because...
Isn't that his tequila? Cabo
yeah.
Wobble.
Yeah, he's yeah. And this might get we are on YouTube now. This might get us pulled, but I don't even care. It's
you
worth
know,
it.
You know Sammy Hagar's first band was called Montrose?
I do know that,
and yes. You know where I live?
My mom and dad actually saw them. Montrose.
They were a great band.
They opened for Kiss at the IMA in Flint, Michigan, USA. Which is ridiculous if you know anything about Flint, the IMA, or recent history. So
I love Bad Motor Scooter. That's a great fucking rock song.
By the way, before I pull this up, everybody, this Friday, March 2nd, there's going to be a documentary on Netflix called Flint Town.
Yeah.
Did you watch the trailer for this?
No, but Mr. David Baldwin was talking about it today, and I had heard about it before.
So. This is a documentary about the Flint police force, and holy shit, does it look intense.
Well, there's not a Flint police force. Do people know that?
That's the trailer.
I haven't watched the trailers.
There's 100,000 people in Flint and...
three cops.
Yeah, exactly. So... I'm watching this and I'm like, holy shit, this looks really good. This looks really intense. And hey, I know that place because I live 5 minutes away from it. It's kind of freaks me out.
Makes you feel safe, right?
Yeah, it freaks me out. And like, there's one part where the cops pull up to an intersection and this random drunk bum wanders over to their window that's down and he goes, motherfucker.
To the cops.
Yeah, and I'm like...
The cops are like, we don't have time to deal
with this. I swear to God, I know that guy and every guy like that. Like,
you're like, that's George.
Yeah, exactly.
He's an all right guy. He's just a little drunk right now.
It hits a little bit too close to home. Right? It freaks me out. I'm like, this is... And the way it's filmed, it's not some fucking shitty episode of Cops. It's like really cinematic and shit.
I will tell you that I stopped at a gas station today in Flint in a place that I probably shouldn't have stopped. But I realized if I didn't stop, then I would have had to get gas on the way to the podcast. And I didn't want to be even later than I already was. So this was earlier today. It was still light out. But at the time that I was at this gas station, I probably saw four bums walk around the back of the gas station and come back around. Four different ones. I'll walk around. I only put $20 in gas in.
Yeah.
And one guy that was pumping gas to me, who wasn't a bum, but kind of looked like a thug, if I could say that. I mean,
bum thugs in harmony.
Yeah. He walked around the back of the gas station too. And it was just woods back there. So I don't know what was going on back there.
No, it wasn't just woods. There was also drugs back there. That's was going on.
I stayed on the other side.
Yeah.
I
did okay.
I did not go to the dark side.
Okay. Well, I kind of want to. It looks really good and I want to watch it. But
I'm definitely going to watch it.
But I'm like, man.
No, you got to watch it.
Well, I do have to watch it. And it's funny that it's called Flint Town because everyone calls it Flint Town Flint Town. Everybody's called it Flint Town forever, but
well, that's why they called it that. I'm sure
it's got to be right. Like, I don't know anything about the filmmakers or anything, but I wonder if they're from the area. They got to be, right?
Well, I mean, they didn't name it Flint Town for no reason. I mean, that's just what people call it.
Well, it sounds better than Flint. So.
Right. Well, everybody calls it Flint Town. So, yeah, they knew what they were naming.
All
right.
So, here's the fucking Van Halen song, and this might get us sued, but I don't care. It's totally worth it.
Really? You can get sued for playing?
Yeah, absolutely.
They're not getting it's on YouTube, though, right?
Yeah.
Well, play it.
I'm going to. I think I got it queued up to where this part is, but if not, we'll deal. Oh, yeah, it's coming up. Wait. Oh, so here's the lyrics I just recited. And then you sense a change. Nothing feels the same. All your dreams are strange. Love comes walking in. Some kind of alien waits for the opening, then simply pulls a string. Now listen to the way he sings it. It sounds
beautiful.
It sounds like the most important thing that's ever happened to you.
Good for Sammy.
He's like a fucking warrior poet right here. So listen. That part.
I know this song.
Life changing.
What's the name of the song, by the way?
Love Walks In.
Okay. Yeah.
By Van Halen. So buy it on iTunes.
If Eddie Van Halen would have been too wasted to know what he was saying.
Yeah. Like you could get by with all those words except the line he says, some kind of alien.
Well, even the string.
Love comes walking in like some kind of alien. Like,
Sammy, did you even try? No, I didn't.
He sings it so sincere, though. You're like, yeah.
It's all about the voice.
Yeah. I mean, all you teens out there, take note. You're listening to your Charlie Puth and whatnot. Oh, you can keep your Puth. I don't need him. I got some Hagar here.
I worked with a guy named Daryl, and I love Daryl. And Daryl's a great guy.
And his brother Daryl, his other brother Daryl.
Larry, Daryl, and Daryl. Daryl is probably 55 years old. Great dude. Great dude.
Oh, just the best guy.
If you meet him, if you know Daryl, you love him. He's a great guy. You know,
you can tell Tommy's drunk.
No, you know,
because he just called a man a great guy.
He is. You know who his favorite rocker is?
Van Halen.
The Red Rocker, Sammy Hagar.
Yeah.
You know what biography I've had for 2 years dedicated to Daryl? I keep forgetting.
Oh, my God. He's got your face on a dartboard right now.
No, he don't care. Like,
how does he not care?
I don't work with him anymore, but he'll put out my Facebook, hey, brother, hope everything's going well.
Yeah, he thinks you died and got buried with his dedicated. Oh, that's
rough.
It's a
great book, actually.
I'm sure it is.
It's really good.
I'm sure it's real special to him, too.
Yeah, but it's dedicated to Daryl, and it's the Red Rocker.
Sorry, Daryl Van Halen. You'll never see that again, just like I'll never see Goodwill Hunting that Tommy's had for 6 years.
I still got it in the super protective Ziploc bag that he gave it to me in. Like, it's not one of those clear Ziploc bags. Like, you can't see it. It's like this heavy duty Ziploc. That's how much he cares about this book. I really need to get it back to him.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, you kind of do.
And it's signed to him.
Yeah.
He paid money to meet and greet him.
So, Tommy, it's National Pancake Day. Did you know this?
I hate pancakes. I really do.
You don't like them?
They're just bread. Like, I don't get it.
They're fancy bread.
Yeah, I don't
get
it.
The breakfast bread.
I don't like them.
You don't like them?
I mean, give me some hash browns.
Give them some hash browns over there.
Biscuits and gravy. Once you've had the biscuits and gravy, you don't want the fucking pancakes.
What's a boy got to do to get some hash browns it's up just, in this mug?
It's fluffy bread.
Just fluffy bread.
That's all it is.
Shit. Who needs it?
You sheeps are just, oh yeah, I'll take the fluffy bread. That's amazing. No. Yeah. Get the biscuits and gravy. Live a little.
Yeah, all you're getting is a short stack of fluffy bread, you posers.
Seriously, I've always hated pancakes. Always.
You can't stand them, I guess.
Are you a pancake fan?
Am I a pancake fan? Every now and
see?
Then.
See? Every it's not one of those things, right?
I will say breakfast foods, for the most part, kick all the ass.
I hardly ever eat breakfast food.
Well, that's dumb, because bacon, sausage, eggs, great, hash browns.
I'm not an egg fan. I'll put an egg on my cheeseburger.
Well, you know what?
But I only have a cheeseburger like twice a year, because I got to find something not to clog the arteries.
Again, you're the pickiest fat man anyone's ever seen.
Well, you got to pick your battles.
Like, what do you eat? Tell me. How do you pack on the pounds?
What did I have today? I've had 4 packs of peanuts today. That's really all I've eaten, I swear to God.
Well, okay, not today, then.
I went to the brewery where my bass player works, and he wasn't there, and he's the only cook. So the guy was like, oh, we don't have food today. And so I just drank instead and got 4 packs of the 2-for-1 peanuts. That's all I've eaten today.
What does a Tommy eat on a normal day to get so plump?
I eat a lot of protein bars. That's like my thing.
Well, that doesn't do anything for you.
Yeah. Yeah. And then I'll have like, I don't know, like the beloved made, we don't know what to call it. It was a bunch of rice and beans, and she calls it Spanish rice, but she's like, it's probably not Spanish rice. It's like rice and beans.
Okay.
It's really good.
Okay.
So we had that for dinner last night.
All right.
So I don't know. Just whatever she makes.
Whatever that woman gets off her ass and cooks.
I like wraps. I do a lot of wraps, I guess.
Battle wraps?
No. Like tomato basil wraps.
Slaying homies on the street.
If I'm in my super big diet mode, then I just eat
super big diet mode, engage.
Then I'll eat a lot of cottage cheese and tuna fish.
Oh, gross.
It's disgusting.
You're the most nastiest person.
Yeah. I mean, if I had it my way, I'd eat pizza for every meal and never stop.
Yeah. You know how to make everyone in the world vomit? Talk with your mouth open while eating cottage cheese. Instant vomit everywhere. It'd be like that scene in Family Guy where they take the Epicac and they're all puking all across the room. So we many moons ago, we came up with this great idea.
Was it great?
Called the Taste Buds. Remember this?
I do. It's still a great idea. You shouldn't be telling the masses.
Yeah, well, so this idea was we were going to go around to restaurants and greasy spoons and eat all the food.
And record it.
Yeah. I also had a similar idea, but kind of refined, on the episode you weren't on with Nick and Tom.
Oh, well, I don't want to hear about it then.
Well, I was going to suggest me and you go to, like, all the places that have... I was going to name it Gluttony Shirts.
Oh.
And I was going to, we would go.
I have a lot of those.
Yeah, exactly. We were going to go to all the places that offer you a shirt if you eat half a pound of hamburgers.
Love it.
In 45 minutes. Right. And that's what we were going to do. And we were going to go around and you were going to eat all that and get even fatter. And then you'd have a gluttony shirt to put on your, and we would be recording the whole time. I still think we should do that.
Sure. I'm down for getting fatter again.
Okay, I'm glad.
Like, I've kind of gave up on the gym the past week.
Okay, so in honor of National Pancake Day, and in honor of the Taste Buds, we're going to give the public a taste of the Taste Buds.
Uh-oh.
You excited for this?
Yeah, I'm salivating.
Good, because what I have right here will change your life.
A Lunchable?
No, these are Peeps.
Oh, my God, I can't do those.
Pancakes and syrup. You have to. You have to for the Taste Buds.
Fine.
I'm going to as well.
Oh, my God.
Listen, I don't want you to chew into the microphone either and gross the entire world out.
God, but I hate Peeps.
Well.
And just, and there's
I'm not a big fan either.
Oh, yeah. This is so sugary.
Look at this. Look at this. Oh, don't God. Worry about
Couldn't
this sugar.
Can we get a Cadbury egg?
Well, those are tasty, though, and that's no fun. We're going to taste the weirdest foods,
I'm
I've
gonna
decided.
I'm going to puke Miller Lite and maple syrup.
Oh, it'll be like you're in your 20s again.
I mean, yeah, except for the maple syrup was Jack Daniels. But.
Well, you used to call it your maple syrup. That's what you used to put on your pancakes.
Right, exactly.
That's why you can't eat pancakes anymore.
You know what I can eat, which is really strange? When I was like 8 years old, my mom bought this these frozen taquitos. And I remember, you know what a taquito is?
No, they're called taquitos.
Oh, is that what they are? The really long tacos?
Yeah,
like
they're mini tacos, literally.
But they're long? Yeah. God, and I remember I ate one. And just talking about it, my stomach's turning. And I thought they were so great, and I ate like six or seven of them because I was a fucking fat kid. I can't take two.
Oh, my God, they're stuck together.
Yeah, well, that's what peeps do.
They stick right to your ribs.
And just fingered the peep.
Wait, don't eat it yet.
Oh.
We're going to do...
You can't put food in my hand and tell
you're
me
like,
not
You're
to
like,
go.
I hate it.
Remember those gluttony shirts?
Yeah, I do.
Ooh,
absolutely.
Oh, my God, it's so bad already.
Wait a minute, though. No, yeah, but it smells exactly like maple syrup and pancakes.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's terrible.
No, I like that smell. You don't like the smell of maple syrup?
I just smell the sugar.
There's, like, loads of sugar on this sprinkled on. You can even see it.
This is going to be the worst.
This is the taste buds, folks. We're eating Peeps maple syrup, and literally the only store I've seen it around here is in the retail paradise that gainfully employs me.
Well,
so
good
I had
for them.
Good for them.
Support,
they got a real coup.
Support your employer.
Yeah. So on the count of three, are you gonna pop the whole thing in and just get it over with?
Let's just fucking joke on it.
And then afterwards, we're gonna give our impressions.
God, I can.
Three, two. Don't chew in the mic either.
Okay.
One.
Not bad so far. That wasn't too bad.
Mm-mm.
There's a little bit of maple syrup aftertaste, but...
It just tastes like a marshmallow. You can't really even taste the maple syrup.
Oh, there it is, though.
That's disappointing.
Right at the end, I got a fucking shot of maple syrup.
You just ate 7,000 calories with one peep.
For real.
You did.
47 grams of sugar.
Yeah, like they smell more like maple syrup than they do they taste it. So I don't
That's very true. They're not that bad. I was surprised. Oh, you're going for You're a monster. Mm-hmm. Yeah, those are... What's the brand?
Peeps is the brand.
That's just the brand. Oh. No off-brand, no great value.
Serving size is four chicks.
Okay.
And it's only 110 per serving.
Bad. That's not bad.
So that was like no calories whatsoever.
What's the grams of sugar, though?
Oh, God. 800,000.
I wouldn't be surprised.
24 grams.
That's not too bad. I mean, it's ridiculous, but...
Hmm.
So yeah, there's 8 grams of sugar in every peep.
That really wasn't as devastating as I expected.
No, it really didn't. I guess we'll have to turn it up next week.
No, I'm going to have to find a weirder...
Anchovies or something.
Yeah, going to have to find a weirder food, that's for sure. By the way, a callback to a few weeks ago, I talked about horny goat weed, which I saw in the gas station.
Yeah.
And horny goat weed is this weird... gas station powder sold by the cash register at certain gas stations, and you buy it, and it claims that you extend your performance or whatnot.
Right.
Well, I went back to that same gas station, and guess what? They were all out of horny goat weed, just an empty shelf right there.
And what would you do now because you got so used to it?
I mean, somewhere out there, ladies, there's a man with a whole system full of HGW. And he's just waiting to find a girlfriend.
Is that what you call it? HGW?
HGW. Why not? Why not? He's just waiting.
Can I talk about my experience in Chicago on the...
Absolutely. Tommy, you were in Chicago.
Yeah. And it was actually... I mean, overall, it was amazing. I mean, the guy that I stayed with, Aaron Putnam, look him up. He's a great Chicago comedian, very nice guy. Puts together a bunch of stuff. He goes, his production is Happy Baby.
Happy Baby.
And he does work his tail off, and he's a hustler, and he's a great dude. He treated me like a king.
By the way, before you go on, David, the producer, and Julia Miranda were supposed to be there, did not show up. They are officially the first people to walk out on your act before it even started. That's how smart they are.
I felt bad.
That's how smart they are.
They had already paid for tickets.
Well, reimburse them. Send them a check. You made loads of money, sir.
I made enough, but it wasn't... I gave a lot of it back to Aaron because he gave me a place to stay and he found me a place to park and
see,
stuff.
See, you're a fucking little sucker bitch over there.
No, not really. I'm a cordial. I'm a pleasant person.
Oh my God.
He hooked me up. So
this drunk Tommy isn't the drunk Tommy I'm used to. This drunk Tommy is a beaten man. I'm a cordial person.
But Aaron had to. Take an L.A. comedian. I can't remember his name, and that sucks, but he was like a big guy.
Big Shot L.A.
Yeah, so Aaron had to take him back to the airport because a big part about being a Chicago comedian is you want to network and you want to... So taking L.A. comedians to the airport is great, and he had some business with the guy. I think he had him on a show. Anyway, so I'm sitting in Aaron's apartment, and I got his key fob. And I'm like, well, I'm going to run down and find some Chicago-style pizza, right? And he lives in a really nice area of town. And I go find this pizza place, and I finally found it. And it wasn't, God, it all of a sudden became not a seedy area of town, because he lives in a really good area of town. But it was just like, there were people smoking weed on the sidewalk, like openly, like passing it to one another. And it was
God's
like,
own reefer.
Oh, yeah, my. And it was just, there was a lot of people hollering around, and I'm like, okay, and it was
bunch of hollowers.
It's kind of off the beaten path, you know, because I walked for probably a mile or two, and I got to the pizza place, and
really
I
really sounds like you're in a Huck Finn novel.
I sat down at the pizza place, and I sat there for 15 minutes, and nobody waited on me, like nobody. So I got up and left, and I went back around the corner to this nice Mexican place, and
maybe...
Had a really good Mexican dinner by myself in Chicago, like the loser I am. But the show was amazing. It was a really nice place. It was an organic bar called the Uncommon Ground. And I do want to give a big shout out to Aaron Putnam because he hooked me up really good, and he's a great guy, and his apartment's super nice.
What up, A Putz?
So that was nice. But
excellent.
Just kind of like, and I Ubered around by myself like a real boy.
Look at you.
Yeah.
An Uber man over there.
The last Uber guy I got was super cool. I was like, hey, man, I'm just going to sit here. I was drunk at this point, of course.
No.
I was like, I'm just going to sit in the back and not say anything. And he's like, no, brother, what you want to talk about?
So it was like, wrong thing to say.
15-minute drive around town that he was just super enthralled that I was a comedian. And
yeah,
we had a good talk.
Yeah,
his name was Steven. He drove a Toyota Camry.
Yeah. Did you and Steven just sit there while he idled and talk a little bit?
No.
Running up that tab.
We did not do that. But he was very nice to drop me off at the rate. Not on the street. He pulled into the...
He didn't toss you out of a moving vehicle.
No. He's like, oh, is that where you're at? I'll drive right around. So he, on the unloading dock, I guess. So it was nice. I mean, overall, I loved it. And
like you were a piece of freight.
Yeah. Huh. I wish the beloved or the kids could have been there with me.
Here come the tears. Jesus Christ.
Kind of weird to be in a spot that you really want to be in, but you're alone. I guess that's the road comic.
I mean, do we want to break this down, your tears and sorrow?
Yeah.
Do you want to get real, real, real right now?
No, because I'm very grateful for the experience, so.
Tell the people what you're going through right now. Listen, I've bled all over this podcast for many years. You can bleed once in a while.
Well, it just kind of sucks being on the road alone. You know, I love to take the beloved and the kids, and I do get to take them sometimes. But sometimes I'm on the road alone, and it's like, God damn it. And I always get them a T-shirt, you know. So that kind of helps, I guess, because when I'm back home and I see them wearing that T-shirt, I'm like, yeah, they knew I was thinking about them. So then that, but still in the same sense, I put a goal together that five new states this year, and I've already gotten two. That just kind of hits home, I guess. And
like I told you,
now that I'm a traveling comedian and I'm everywhere, like, I drive 5 hours away and I'm like, I can't take it anymore.
And like I told Tommy, the girls are gossiping about boys and could not care less about his existence.
Whether I'm there or not.
And his beloved certainly needs a break from him because he's a lot to deal with. So
I am a lot to deal with. Holy shit.
Yeah. I mean, that voice alone that she just made was like, woo.
But then again, I told Randy that yesterday a new agency called me and they're going to start booking me. And so.
Big time.
Of course. Well, no. But I mean, it's they're based out of Ohio. So my first gig is in Southern Ohio, and I didn't think twice of saying yes to it. So.
See?
So I guess it's back on the road I go.
How many times did you plug the podcast in Chicago?
A couple times.
Bullshit.
Not on stage, but I talked about it a lot.
You're a piece of garbage.
I talked to a bunch of local comedians about it. I really did.
Okay. I don't believe you.
Well, if you looked at the event that you shared for me of the show, did you notice that in my bio it says I am the co-host of the Miserable Retail Slave podcast?
Yeah, because it was copy and pasted from your website.
So I have it on the website that I have this podcast.
With no link.
I don't know how to do that. You're going to have to help me out.
You're not a Zelda man over there.
If they're interested, they'll just Google it.
Misconnections, Tommy.
Sure.
Sure. You want to cry some more? Or?
No, I think I'm good. Okay. I think that was fine. I'll do it on the way home.
Okay. Good. Misconnections, Tommy. Last week, I brought up my new arch enemy. His name is El Silencio.
Yeah.
He's one of our cast of gas station characters, much like Nathan. You have a great day now.
Yeah, the motherfucker did not say that.
Snubbed you. Denied Insane. Your privileges.
This guy's been working there for what, at least 10 years?
45 years.
I mean, I think since the beginning of this podcast, we've talked about him.
Yeah. He looks like
he works at a gas station.
He does.
Like his hair's always a little un.
He looks like Toadstool from the Mario games. He looks like he has a mushroom head.
You know he has a motorcycle?
A mortar-cycle?
Motorcycle.
Is that a cycle that
He saw me pull up on my hog one day. And
don't ever say that again. That's gross.
I was saying it as a joke, but you didn't catch on.
No, I caught the joke. It was still gross.
And he's like, hey, man, I got a motorcycle. And he showed it to me.
What is it, a moped?
No, it was almost worse. It was like this. It looked like a moped with a bunch of luggage attached to it. Like it's just one of these motorcycles from 1984 that Honda put together.
Excellent.
So, are you sure it made it here? Did you get it towed here?
So anyway,
good for him. He's in the wind.
Man, he's a traveling man. So anyways, El Silencio is a man that refuses to acknowledge my existence or talk to me every time I enter this gas station establishment, right?
Uh-huh.
So today I'm looking, and I'm looking at misconnections because that's the thing we do. I look on the Craigslist, and we try to connect the lost lovers together. That's our whole, we're like online cupids over here.
Right.
So I see a misconnection of a man seeking man, and the man describes the gas station where El Silencio works at, and he describes the earring in El Silencio's ear, and I'm like, I'm like, holy shit, El Silencio's got a misconnection. I should totally let him know.
Yeah,
I should.
Right. Do it.
I'm like, there's a dude that wants to bang you. Do you want to bang him?
Yeah, let's do it. Let's get it.
Go bang that dude. He likes your earring and the way you
it's 2018.
Are silent.
We can do that. We can hook it up.
Bang all the dudes, everyone. Why not? But I thought that was hilarious.
Bang Randy, dudes.
Ew.
Ew. What, he had something wrong with that lifestyle, Randy? Randy.
Misconnections, Tommy. East Lansing, Michigan, USA. Mancy
Rubies.
Came, Rubies, hey girl, hey. She hates me.
Does she really?
Rubies, who hates my stinking guts.
Does she really? She came to my wedding. She better not hate you.
She came with me to your wedding.
Okay,
yes.
But she was still at my wedding.
That's true. Did you know she was kind of, and I didn't know this until afterwards, that she was kind of concerned about being there because you talked shit about her on the podcast?
Oh, no way. Yeah. She didn't get that I was, oh, no, she's a great person.
Yeah. I didn't find out until really? Like afterwards. And I'm like, oh.
I didn't get that vibe from her. I thought she knew it
no,
was
No, because
all just
she gets
a joke.
Along with everyone.
Yeah, I thought she knew it was just a joke. I was just busting her balls.
I don't,
oh, that's sad. Rubies, I didn't mean it that way.
I don't remember how it was brought up, but I was like, she Aww. Was like, oh, so Tommy doesn't hate my guts? I'm like, what? What?
No. No. I just had to give her a little bus ball. Bus ball bust.
Had to give you some bus balls.
About the time and distance thing.
How you like that, bus balls?
That was just a little cliche, like saying I don't want to date you.
Bus balls.
No, of course not.
Anyways. Speedway Nachos.
Uh-huh.
Last night, you were probably the most entertaining part of my night.
Speedway Nachos. Is that really?
That's the headline, yeah.
So is he talking to the nachos?
I kind of think so now.
Yeah. I would think so, right? Like, that would be the most entertaining night of my night. Or the most anything. If I got some Speedway Nachos, oh, God, I'd write about it.
Yeah. I think he wants the woman, though, not the chose. Last night, you were probably the most entertaining part of my night. You were ranting and raving about them, the Speedway Nachos, and I stopped so you could get some. Before we got there, we were talking about other local food that was really good, capital
Wait,
G.
Wait, so he was with her before they went to the Speedway Nachos?
I kind of think he might have been like an Uber driver or something.
Okay, yeah, because that's weird.
What was it and the name of the place? I hope this finds you, and we could possibly go to that place soon to get some lunch.
Back to the Speedway. Like, is that, he means Speedway gas station, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
So he wants to meet her back at the Speedway gas station to have some lunch? Do they have, like, a booth?
I mean, this girl must be the most precious angel. They had a conversation about Speedway Nachos. And he's a head over heels.
Have you had them? They might be amazing. I don't know.
I don't. There was a stint where Paulie Walnuts and I would go to the fucking Speedway and have Speedway hot dogs all the time, which is a bad idea.
I stopped in Michigan City, Indiana on the way to Chicago, and the pizza at this gas station looked so fucking good. But I calmed myself.
You
and I did not
yourself.
Do it.
You had some self-restraint.
But
there.
I wanted to. It looked really fucking good. I don't think it was a Speedway. I think it was like a Quick and Serve or something. Either way.
Quick and Serve.
It was on that little spinny microwave hot plate. But it looked fantastic.
Misconnection, Tommy. Beautiful Flint, Michigan, USA. Man-seeking woman. Sugar-coated gumdrop is the headline.
Oh, is that like an edible?
Maybe. Next to thing one and thing two, you are the best one that has happened to me.
Those must be his kids?
I'd imagine. Hey. I am constantly thinking of you and miss you every day.
Mm.
If JH isn't the right fit, I'd love the chance to try again. Slowly this time, though, LOL.
What was the first sentence? Sorry.
Next to thing one and thing two.
So that's, yeah, what was the headline?
Sugar-coated gumdrop.
That's right. Okay. So, JH, really?
I love these misconnection homewreckers.
Right? Like, that's, you couldn't have sent her an email?
Yeah. Let me ruin your life via Craigslist. If JH isn't the right fit, I'd love the chance to try again. Slowly this time, though. I know the munchkins wouldn't be opposed to it.
Aw.
Love you lots. Signed, Honey Bunny Boogie Bear.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Honey Bunny Boogie Bear wants a sugar coated gumdrop. Thing one and thing two. This guy's insufferable.
Like, did he just get blocked on all social media? He has no other outlet.
Not only that, he just got blocked from the entire internet for all of his days. He's too gross to exist on the World Wide Web.
Aww.
Unless you want to listen to this podcast, in which case, join our Facebook group. Search Miserable Retail Slave on the Facebook.com.
Yes, sir.
Leave us a 5-star positive iTunes review also on that iTunes.com. Would you, could you, please? If you've got a friend, and why would you? Why would you have a friend?
You got a friend in
you
me.
Listen to podcasts, and that's weird of you. Like, why would you do that?
You got a friend in me.
Maybe suggest that friend check out this podcast. Maybe not this episode.
What song were we talking about at the beginning?
Because everybody was drunk, and Tommy was drunk and insufferable.
No, this was a good podcast.
Well,
don't stand behind it.
Okay, well, that's because you're drunk. If you stand behind it, you'd promote it once in a while.
Oh,
you
maybe
never
I
do.
Will.
You won't. Trust me. You won't.
Can I promote one crazy story?
Oh, yeah, you can do that, yeah.
I'm going to be on this podcast called One Crazy Story with Nate Armbruster. He's a great comedian out of Detroit, and he has comedians on that they tell the craziest story of their life. And last night I was half drunk laying in bed, and I was like, oh, you know what? I should pitch this to Nate. So I got a hold of him, and he loved the idea. So look for that. I'll let you guys know when I'm going to be on it, but I think we're going to do it sometime next week. So.
Wow. What a tease. Tommy's going to be on another podcast, and he won't
promote
this one.
Craziest story of my life.
He won't promote this one. In the meantime.
Yeah, winners and losers.
There it is. In the meantime, go ahead and follow me on MRetailSlave on the Twitters so I can tickle your Twitters all day long. Follow me on the Instagram. This is the Retail Slave Podcast.
This song reminds me when I had so much hope.
How's it now that your dreams are crushed?
Heart-wrenching.
Exactly. Also, on the social network Vero now, which has just started.
What the hell is going on with Vero? Everybody's crazy about Vero.
It's the new hottest thing.
But I saw it started in 2015, so what Jenner kicked this off?
I don't know. People are real stoked about it now. The first 1,000,000 users are free. After that, they're going to charge. Holy shit.
Speaking of Nate Armbruster, he was super excited that he got the handle Nate. Just to be
congratulations.
Funny. He was like, holy shit. Wow. Somebody posted on it. He's like, I'm going to try to get Nate. And he wrote back and he said he actually got it.
Amazing.
It's just Nate.
That's great. There was one more thing I was going to say, and I completely forgot because you were talking. Good. I like that.
Crank it up.
We'll see you next time, I guess.